Hallelujah. Glory to God. So we have another day to get into the Word, to feast on the Word. Well, the day's over, but we still have time, okay? I think it's very, very important that I mention that the Holy Spirit is leading me to study the Nephilim, to get more information about the Nephilim, about the giants that will soon make their appearance. That I don't know, the Holy Spirit is leading me that way. Like I told you last night, I think I just died. Like I fell asleep like that, just like in 2 seconds, without warning. The Holy Spirit is leading me to, because I was looking at so many things and digging up so many things about fallen angels and the giants, especially the giants. So I think we're gonna have to dig up in that a little bit, but I'm gonna ask Father what he wants me to give, and of course I'll only give what he gives me. Darn, my battery's dead. Not good. Hey, please just kind of fix yourself. Nope. Okay, just give me a second. My battery's really dead. It's gone. It's just zero. Nothing. Okay, anyway, moving on. So let's get into the Bible. Get your Bible. The most important thing is we let the Bible explain the Bible. And for the simple reason, Abba Father's living word, he is the Holy Spirit. And it's his word that's alive in here. It's his word written. Okay, so where are we going? The days of Noah, Genesis 6. Okay. Father, what do you want me to speak on? And this exact thing is the giants. I need worship music and a scripture page, and we'll get started.
He deserves the glory and the honor. I lift my hands in worship.
Worship music. This morning he gave some things as well, but I guess they ought to be studied, but they are really words rich for your spirit and with time that we're entering, because there are so many things that are not being said, so many things that are not being taught, so many things that are just, they left the people without. So now when these things are coming upon, people are like, but I thought the rapture was supposed to happen before this. And now people are like, they're scared. Some are abandoning Christianity. Some are saying, if this is the price that you pay for following Christ, then they're leaving. Their apostasy is happening. And like I said, there's a lot of, like Father said, there's a lot of wolves on the pulpit, and they're preaching peace, 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 but there will be no peace. Jesus didn't come to bring peace. He knows Satan and his legion were cast down, and he knows that Satan's not happy about that. So we're not expecting him to be peaceful. We have to expect, it's a war that we're in. Abba Father is the chief priest, the chief commander of heaven's army, but Satan and his legion are here to do damage to humanity. And if we read in Genesis 6, some people say, why is God allowing this? Why doesn't he just take over and just destroy all the evil? And because all of creation is for his glory. It's for his good pleasure. That's why it was all made. So all of this right now is showing why he's on the throne. And it's just bringing him more glory. It's bringing him more glory. It's what is he is to be glorified. He is a loving father. He's one who there's no sin, there's no darkness in him. So everything that's happening, even if it's evil, even if it's, you know, as hard as it is the stomach, everything is going to bring him glory at the end. Okay, so Genesis chapter 6, reading from verse 1. And it says, now it came to pass, when men began to multiply on the face of the earth. So, God said, be fruitful and multiply, yeah? Just a second. Let me just go back to this. A shower is for what? To water the trees? The sky just went into a complete blue. There's no cloud in there anymore, like none. Okay, so God said, go be fruitful and multiply. But I heard this talk, I heard this thing that they said, there's a thing that people would do when they didn't want women to carry babies, when they didn't want them to bear a child, because they said it was very, what is the word they used? The shape of the woman, they detested it. So to abort the baby, that was like a must. If you, or it was considered what is that word? Abominable thing? Abominable? Is abominable okay? No? Well, anyway, so it was not an easy thing even, okay? And if we see right now in this time as well, man, the things that are going on with abortion is crazy, right? Genesis chapter 6. So, I mean, for people to have babies, and they're actually a blessing, especially when you got a girl that could make more. And, well, you know, babies were blessings. Okay, babies are blessings. Genesis 6, now it came to pass, when men began to multiply on the face of the earth and daughters were born to them, that the sons of God, that is the angels, saw the daughters of men. Now they are holy creatures. They were holy creatures. They were made for the worship of God and for the work of heaven. But that's not what they were focused on. They were lusting after the woman, okay? And it says in Genesis 6, verse 2, that the sons of God saw the daughters of men, that they were beautiful, and they took wives for themselves of all whom they chose. So, gorgeous woman, the angels, they took them. What do you mean they took them? They had sex with them, they took them. And it says in verse 3, the Lord said, my spirit shall not strive with man forever, for he is indeed flesh. Well, of course, God gave us 120 days at most, as opposed to how many, 900 and you know, that amount. He cut it down, yeah? When the Bible says we'll reign with Christ for 1,000 years, it shows that something something is pleasing to him, because who will reign with him? The righteous, the saints. And then, well, look how long they live. 1,000 years into forever, right? So he says, the Lord said, my spirit will not always strive, shall not strive with man forever. For he is indeed flesh. Yea, his days shall be 120 years. That's full length of life. There were giants in the earth, on the earth in those days. And also afterward, there were giants on the earth in those days, and also afterward, when the sons of God came into the daughters of men, they bore children to them. They became pregnant. And it says those were mighty men of who were of old. Those were the mighty men who were of old and men of renown. So angels are supposed to be about heavenly business. Angels are spiritual creatures, and they've fallen. They have done their own thing, and you know, they're now mixing the blood. They're mixing the bloodline. And when God made Adam and Eve, he did it with such innocence. He made them so innocent, so beautiful, so pure, so perfect, that if they were to have children, when they had children, it would have been such a perfect, pure thing. But of course, he had to show himself as our savior, so he allowed what Satan did to happen. Okay, but Satan's thing is to mix the bloodline. He wants to mix. He wants to take what God, remember, Satan has no creative power, none. But he wants to be called creator. That's Satan's thing. Satan wants to be called God. He wants to be known as God. So he took human DNA and angel, whatever, and mixed them, right? And this is what we have. Of course, the giants were born onto them. Why? Because God didn't want, there was a curse upon them for that. The curse is that, just a second, I'll find it. The curse was when the angels went into the daughters of men, that they would be extra large. I don't know what you want to call that, giants, yeah? Just, they're going to be different, so you can differentiate, and it's going to be, it's like, almost as if when God cursed Canaan, I hear him saying Canaan, the mark of Canaan on his forehead. We're going to check that out right now. Why am I thinking, not Canaan, Cain. Is Cain a giant? Wait, Cain. You know something that makes them stand out? Genesis 4. Okay, Genesis 4, verse 9. Then the Lord said to Cain, where is Abel, your brother? He said, I do not know. Am I my brother's keeper? So instead of being, you know, the way God made it to be, they became something else. They, like, just like Cain became envious. He became angry. He wanted dominance, and that's what's happening. Of course, Satan is the frightful one. He's the serpent, and this was his kind of, how to say, this is his seed. It says, what have you done? The voice of your brother's blood cries out to me from the ground. Remember, there's life in the blood. So now you are cursed from the earth, which opened up its mouth to receive your brother's blood from your hand. When you till the ground, it shall no longer yield its strength to you. A fugitive and a vagabond you shall be on the earth. So it's like singled out. Okay, you did this. This is your punishment. So just like when the angels had babies, they couldn't just go and mingle. No. They couldn't just go mingle and make more chaos. There, all those people looking at giants will see that they're giants, right? Now it says here, and Cain said to the Lord, my punishment is greater than I can bear. Now Cain got driven out, but God put a mark on him so nobody could kill him, right? Now, these giants, they want us to be born, okay? But they're still life. They are life. Who gives life? God gives life. Why did he permit it? Why did God permit the daughters of men to give birth to the babies? Because he has a plan. Remember he said in Genesis somewhere, I think in 3, your seed against my seed, remember? Even till Christ, okay? Because of course the Father is Jesus, because we are born through him as a new creation unto God. That is receiving his blood shed on the cross and then coming to him in the holy place through his blood. And also all the gift of the Spirit and everything else that comes with it. But Satan is the father of lies. He is the father of the giants. He's the father of the Nephilim, because they mixed everything. They tried to mix everything. What do I mean? They slept with animals. They tried to mix everything. Everything. Satan cannot create. Satan is more like a mad scientist. He sees everything and he wants to go mix everything and be called creative, but he's not. He's not a creator. So Genesis 3 verse 14, so the Lord said to the serpent, because you've done this, what have you done? It's speculation that, yeah, well, it's just speculation. I'm not going to say it, but oh, yeah, well, let's just see this here right now. Genesis 3, verse 14 to 16. So the Lord said, the Lord God said to the serpent, because you've done this, what have you done? You've deceived the woman to eat from the tree that she was told not to eat, else she would die. Not even touch it, else she would die. Right? Because you've done this, you are cursed more than all the cattle and more than every beast of the field. On your belly you shall go. You will eat dust all the days of your life. And I will put enmity between you and the woman, between your seed and her seed. Check this out. Cain hated Abel. Check this out. Wait. This kind of makes sense. Cain hated Abel, right? As well as between your seed and her seed. Remember, woman is church in Revelation. And the seed are the people or the members of the body of Christ who are filled with the Holy Spirit. The serpent seed are those who are ravaged by demons living inside of them. So there's going to be a hatred, just like light and darkness, just like truth and lie, just like God and Satan. Okay? It's like totally against each other. Genesis 3, chapter 15, and I'll put enmity between you and the woman, between your seed and her seed. He shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel. Just like on the cross, where Jesus was crucified and Satan thought he'd won, yay, done deal, that's what he thought. But then he crushed his head because he overcame death and hell for us. Now, the cross is a perfect example to look at what God is doing. Even as he allows the Nephilim to thrive, because from God comes the breath of life. God loved the angels before they fell. He loved them. Now, and he loves his creation. Why is he allowing? Why even now? Even now, because it's happening. Just as it was happening in the days of Noah, it's happening now. And, okay, he's bringing to my memory. Remember when he gave a revelation on Kali and Shiva and all of that that they worship? And he was showing that even then, angels are impregnating women. Not angels anymore, but demons. They're called demons because they've fallen. They're against God, rebellious. That even as they bow to those things, it's like a gateway opened for the angels, the fallen angels. Remember God showed that whole, I'm sure it's somewhere on my timeline somewhere. I never made a video of it, I think. Should have. Anyway, he's showing me that. And he said, why is he allowing it to happen? Because of the stubbornness of man. Because their hearts are going cold towards their creator. And God is not a God of force. He does not force. He allows you to make your decision. The only thing about that is he is judge. And you cannot change the consequences of whatever you choose. So the Hindus are doing their thing. The Muslims are doing their thing. The Buddhists are doing their thing. Everybody's doing their thing. And God is saying, okay, for now, let it be. You have your way. And then, of course, when judgment comes, because he's already given everything that we need, it's like the days of Noah all over again, where he's saying, Noah, go build your ark. Noah, the flood is coming. And Noah says, yes, Lord. And then Noah goes to share the news, and people laugh at him. So God is saying, listen, the Nephilim are on the earth. They are here. It's not like they're coming. They are here. The giants are here. They're hiding in remote places. And when they are discovered, okay. Even last night, I had this thought come into me. And I was thinking, I can't remember if the Holy Spirit told me, or I was thinking that the giants are going to be used as a military thing as well for war. Because like men war against each other and stuff, you know, if they have a giant there, then it's gonna make things more favorable on the side that has a giant, right? So they're gonna try. Mankind has gone nuts. They're gonna try to enslave the giants in that. I don't know when it's gonna happen, but it's gonna happen. But it's gonna backfire. Because the giants are gonna look upon themselves as superior. Because Satan is a one of pride. And of course God made us, and he made us in his image and likeness, but Satan's seed is made in the image of Satan. The thing that fathered them is a snake. It's a serpent. It's a dragon. It's the devil. It's rebellion. So it's in their blood. And God is allowing it because he says, you know what? They can be 40 feet tall. Why did I say 40 feet tall? I don't know why I said 40 feet tall. They could be 40 feet tall. And the Bible says, greater is he inside of us than he who is outside or who is in the world, right? Now, we can look, it's like David and Goliath all over again. God is allowing, he is allowing the testimony to come. He is, it's not just like we read a book, we read the Bible, and okay, great, yeah, good story. Thank you, God. Thank you for that testimony. Thank you for that awesome revelation. That God wants us to have our testimony. Some of us, whoever is chosen to live in that time. Father, may your spirit be with us all. Okay, here's what he says. I'll put enmity between you and the woman, and between your seed and her seed. And he shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel. To the woman he said, I'll greatly multiply your sorrow and your conception. In pain you shall bring forth children. Your desire shall be for your husband, and he shall rule over you. You're going to remember exactly what you did. You listen to the serpent, not the creator. But God would allow it because God is able to bring something good out of that. Just like, okay, in a normal thinking, if we look at David and Goliath, it never said how tall David was. It never said how tall Goliath was. But he's a giant in front of them. He's a Philistine. He's against the people of God. He looks like he's got the advantage. But at the end of the day, what stood out? The God of Israel. God is the one who fights the battle. So God is allowing us to witness these things, to know that, hey, it's not just some myth. Oh, it's not just that the Bible is just written 100 times over. Or, no. These things exist. They exist, and Satan does exist. And you better believe if there's a God, there's a devil. Or if there's a devil, there's a God. There is a devil, and there is a God. And the devil has come down having great wrath against humanity. He hates humans. Anything made in the image of God, he hates. So you don't have to do Satan anything. You don't even have to be working for the kingdom of God for Satan to hate you. He hates you because you were born. He hates you because he knows that God purposed you. Okay? So we're looking at Genesis 6 again, into verse 4. There were giants on the earth in those days. The Bible says, as it was in the days of Noah, so it shall be coming of the Son of Man. All right. Jesus, I'm supposed to be finding these things, you know. The Bible also says, shall I find faith on the earth when I return? I hear him saying that, shall I find faith? Maybe he's more likely to find fear. Matthew 24. Matthew 24, verse 36 to 39. Okay. I'm hearing Spanish. I'm hearing Spanish. I am ridden with just conviction of finding things about giants right now. Just the Nephilim, it's important that we know why they're here, what they plan to do. walking around this world. All right, here we go. I thought by now they... Matthew 24, verse 36 to 39. But of that day and hour, no man knows, no, not even the angels in heaven, but my Father only. Only God knows this day. Okay? But as it was in the days of Noah, so it shall be at the coming of the Son of Man. So we have to look into the days of Noah to see what exactly everything about giants in the Bible. Everything about the Nephilim. The Nephilim were on the earth in those days. The Nephilim. Now things like, I don't even want to go there, but things like the capybara and the all these odd things, like people keep spotting, and they call them myths and legends, and these are actually the fallen that have bred animals. They have, remember, I was saying this is even how dinosaurs came about. Like dinosaurs, they tried to take the animals that God made and breed them, interbreed them, just mix them and create all kinds of craziness. But even so, on the earth, this is happening in these days. This is actually happening. And of course, they're keeping it under wraps. So any strange thing that any strange phenomenon or any strange creature that's discovered, what happens? It's blocked off, it's taken under wraps, and it's hidden. Right? Right. That's exactly what happens. Now, okay. Give me something on the Nephilim Bible. Here we go. It says, for in the days that were before the flood, they were eating and drinking and marrying and giving in marriage. They're just having a ball. Nobody cared. It's like, okay, they said this time, but this time is past, so let's eat and drink, for tomorrow we die, or whenever we'll die, you know, it's like that. And it says, and knew not until the flood, okay, until the day that Noah entered the ark. So they eating and drinking constantly, marrying and giving in marriage, until the day that God said, Noah, I'm going to bring the flood. And Noah enters the ark, and he's saved. But they continue eating and drinking. So somebody might have been having a wedding. Somebody might have been having a birthday party. Somebody might have been just doing about their merry, whatever they do. And the flood came and swept it all away. And it said, and knew not until the flood came and took them all away. So shall the coming of the Son of Man be. Now, here's what he's telling, okay? As he says, no one knows the day or the hour, not even the angels, not the angels in heaven, okay? Now, he wants, it's not just us that are going to be caught by surprise. It's Satan as well. He knows he has a short time, but God is going to delay a little bit. Just a little bit, so that when he thinks that he's got it in the bag, God will show up with the sovereignty. Because the reign of the Antichrist is coming on the earth. And of course, he's evil. He is the embodiment of that fallen angel in a human body. I hope it's human. And all the giants that are underground, they're going to come out. They're underground. Why do you think all the planes that are disappearing and the ships that disappear and people that are just disappearing, some of human trafficking is to feed the giants. Did you know that? It's like Satan's trying to prepare his own army. He thinks that if he gets enough, I don't know what, creatures, whatever. He thinks if he gets enough, he could overthrow God. That's what he thinks. He's got another thought coming. Because God is allowing it to show why he's on the throne. And giants are, they're huge. A normal man, okay, a normal man range from what height? Maybe till like, not 7 feet even. Come on, a normal man, 6 foot something. I've seen 6 foot eight people, but 6 foot five-ish, okay, tall people, they're tall people. But giants, they go all into 12 feet, double that, 15 feet, 20 feet. Those are powerful beings, but it's all coming down to the battle in the spirit. Because just like David stood up to Goliath, the people in those days, the people in those times, the people in that soon coming time is gonna have to stand up with a faith like David that stood up to Goliath, even though his size, even though he had all the advantage in a physical sense. We have to know that we wrestle not against flesh, but spirit. Amen? So it's like a testing kind of. It's to bring about, it's like God is going to be glorified even more. Whatever he's doing that is allowing this to happen, he's whatever he's allowing to happen is that his glory will be known higher still. And those who trust in him will be glorified in him. Of course, he's the one who holds forever. He's the one who all things are working for. And he's the winner at the end. So we're looking at giants. And it said clean animals and unclean animals. You know when the Bible says, take every clean animal, unclean animal, and the Bible lists what is clean and what is unclean to God. Now, how do I say this properly? Satan looks to oppose things to God. Everything that God says is holy to him and perfect to him and just to him. Satan wants the opposite of that. He's like the rebellious son you never wanted. Everything that the father says do, he does the opposite of. He thinks that he's got everything in his clothes because he's on the earth, and because we are human and he is spirit, he thinks that he has got the advantage. But God made that battle very even. God came and he gave us the gift of his Holy Spirit. So now it's not just flesh or just humans against spirit. No, it's spirit against spirit, because the battle is the Lord's. Amen? The whole reason he's coming against, and he's not coming against all of humanity immediately. No, he's coming against the seed of the woman. And woman is church in Revelations. And of course, the people who Christ is the head. Okay, so that's some information we didn't really want to know, but we know now that Satan is not after all of humanity. Why? If he could and everyone could perish, great for him. But right now he's after the one threatening his reign to come. And he knows that God is going to give him that time, because we serve a just and righteous God. So look at this. Jesus' ministry was 3.5 years, right? How long was the reign of the Antichrist, the false prophet, and the beast? Did I say that right? Yeah, the Antichrist, false prophet, and the beast. 3.5 years. But check this out even. How long is God's judgment, his wrath, to be poured out? 3.5 years. So he's proving something. But he's not meddling. He's just empowering the people that would trust in him. That's where we come in. Because if we trust in him, we are going to overcome. It's not a if. We are. Okay? And he is allowing He is allowing Satan to show what happens under his rule, because two-thirds of the angels stayed back in heaven. God doesn't want them worshiping him out of fear. Not the kind of fear like, oh, if I don't worship him, he'll kill me. No, not like that. You know, he wants a reverential fear, a love, an adoration. He wants everybody to work in his rule, under him, in love, and just be a big happy family in holiness. That's what he wants. But of course, that's not how it is, because Satan came and did his poo, and with Eve and Adam, and this whole thing came about. But God had a plan for him way before that. So he already planned for him before Satan was even planning what he was going to plan to do to Eve. So the giants are just another thing that we can look upon and say, the battle was never flesh. The battle was never physical. The battle is spiritual. And again, I told you, just like David took down Goliath with a rock. Now, in normal thinking, the men thought that he should have been dressed up in armor and, you know, going like if. Because, okay, if you look at this giant, they're muscular, and one swing, and they're going to hurt you, and that's fear. That is fear, and that's what Satan wants. Satan wants humanity to fear him. He wants humanity to fear him, and that's why he's coming up with all his creations. Not his creations, he doesn't create. Creation is when you make something out of nothing. He is, what is he? He's a fraud. Yeah, to fear his experiments. There we go. To fear his experiments. That's what Satan wants for humanity to do. To fear his experiments. Because in a human thinking, when we behold something that is bigger than us, stronger than us, scary, destructive, so many things. Whatever, you get the point. We can think carnally or we can think spiritually. It's like even, okay, like a snake, for example. Most people are scared of snakes, even though some are keeping them as pets. I don't know why. Most people are scared of snakes, and the bigger they are, the more destructive that they are, right? Nobody would immediately think, I have dominion over this animal, so I am to be fearless of it. No. People say, oh, you know, it's going to crush me, or it's going to kill me, or whatever. It's like human thinking. Satan wants to get men so much. He wants to get the things that we could see so much in our face that we take our eyes off of the one who's holding everything, which is God. He wants us to be so much on the thing that we see that we don't rely on the spirit. Because remember, Satan's whole thing is to force. So, and he's trying to be a god. That's what he's trying to be. He's trying to be a god, and he has no power. So he needs to rely on. But he is sly. He is cunning. But he's no match for God, because God already knows all his plans. This is the assurance that we have, that God is the beginning and the end. So God is the beginning and the end. He knows all things that are happening. He knows exactly what Satan is planning before Satan plans it. He knew exactly what Satan has planned. He knew the giants. He knew the Nephilim. He knew all the creatures that they would bring out. He knows everything. He knows their exact plans. He knew their exact plans to enslave humanity. He knows that they're going to force people to take the mark of the beast. He knows everything. Everything. Okay, so that is all over. We have to stand by David in this time, like David and Goliath. Yeah? Like how David took him out with not weapon. The Bible says it's not by might, nor by power, but by my spirit, says the Lord. Now, Father says, shall I find faith on this earth when I return? Zechariah 4:6. Do you not know what they are? Replied the angel. No, my Lord, I answered. So he said to me, this is the word of the Lord to Zerubbabel. Not by might, nor by power, but by my spirit, says the Lord of hosts. Okay. Give me a second. We're going to go back. Two verses. Zechariah 4:4. So, guess what's coming on the earth before the coming of Christ? Now, God loves to do this, and I've seen him do this multiple times, and it is his way. He loves to do this. He loves that the false would be seen, that when the truth is revealed, people run from darkness to light. He loves, I said that right, didn't I? He said he loves, how to say, he loves the darkness to be seen first, so that when the light comes, it dispels all the darkness, that whatever is caught up in the dark is set free. And guess who's that? That's us. Amen. He loves how's he saying it? It's like, okay, the lie might be made known, that when the truth comes, the truth will set you free. Something like that. The lie must be shown. He allows the lie to show, and that the truth, when it comes, it'll dissipate, it'll kill the lie. And out of that, what is the purpose of that? That a soul would break free from the lie. A soul would realize, now God doesn't have to do anything for that soul to realize that it's the truth. It's the testimony, that's it. It's the testimony that the soul receives, the conviction that God is who he says he is. Zechariah 4 verse 3. There are also two olive trees beside it, one on the right of the bowl and the other on the left. What are these, my Lord? Asked the angel. I asked the angel who was speaking to me, with me. Do you not know what they are? Replied the angel. No, my Lord, they answered. Two witnesses. Okay, and it says, he said to me, this is the word of the Lord to Zerubbabel. Not by might, nor by power, but by my spirit, says the Lord of hosts. So remember, he said also that before that great day, I will send Elijah. People just get into me now. They found me. Okay. That's it. Malachi 4:5. Remember the law of Moses, my servant, the statutes and the ordinances I commanded him for all of Israel at Horeb. Behold, I will send you Elijah the prophet before the coming of the great and dreadful day of the Lord. And he will turn the hearts of the fathers to the children and the hearts of the children to their fathers. Otherwise, I will come and strike the land with a curse. Okay. Now, the spirit of Elijah. What was Elijah doing? Elijah was a prophet of God. He proclaimed the God of Israel, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel. He proclaimed, that was his, he magnified the Lord, okay? And the spirit of Elijah, I will send Elijah. Even the Holy Spirit, when he comes, he will teach you all things. What is the whole point in us even picking up the Bible to read it? What is the whole point in us in these days, as we see the day approaching more so, that what is the point of us even getting into these studies? What is the point of us being led by the Spirit? I give away the answer. The point is to be led by the Spirit and not the flesh, to help me to see, to realize that the battle is not about, even though the battle is on the earth, the battle is not about the earth. The battle is about the spirit realm. It's all spiritual things that are taking place here. And Father wants us to engage in that mindset. He wants us, it's like this. He and the angels that stay back in heaven, they are one. How? I mean, angels attend unto him in his every need, but remember when he gave that revelation, was it Friday, where he said, one is a messenger, one is a protector, one is there for strength, one, like, but God is everything. So the angels are like a manifestation of who he is, each one, you know, in a perfect representation, kind of. But he is the ultimate representation, okay? He's the ultimate deal. He's the ultimate thing. So, Papa, you got to help me out here. Okay, so the whole point of him is of him teaching us or bringing us into his word is that we get that mindset. And again, who had that mindset? Think garden. Think Adam. Adam had that mindset. Adam had the mindset of God, because he and God were one. They were in sync. He was this pure and beautiful creation. So they were in sync. Their thoughts, they blended together. And this is how the angels in heaven are with God. This is how we are going to be when we are like angels in heaven at the resurrection. Satan is the rebellious one. He's not connected. He's not connected to God. He's not connected to the thoughts of God or the things of God. Satan moves in another mindset. And remember, we looked at the spirit having a mind. And of course, Satan, because he's on this world that we can see, he's trying to get. So it's like, you see the battle? The battle is like this. God is leading us this way, and Satan is leading us this way. Why? This way, it's going towards the flesh and the things of the world that we see. So when we become so consumed in it, that the things that Satan is going to bring up, especially towards the reign of the Antichrist, we can flow it. That's what he's hoping humanity does. But God is leading us this way. Why? Because the things of the spirit that he is, there's nothing else to say there, that he is the higher things, and he wants us to be led by that. so that when the Antichrist, so that when it becomes like this, Satan's going about his agenda, but God's plan is still, it's sovereign, it's forever. It's going to reign and we're going to overcome. How do we overcome the dragon? By the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. The blood of the Lamb, how? We beheld him without sin, becoming sin for us. So he is our Savior. First and foremost, we have to look at God as the one who has the battle and who's taking out the devil and death. So we're not fearful of standing up against the lie and standing in the truth. The second thing is to, what's the second thing? Darn, I lost it. Okay, just a second. Ah, I forgot. No. Okay, he's going to give it back. He's going to give it back. So, okay, right. So God wants us to be led fully by the Spirit. So that even if we see a giant, okay, you see on the news, a giant discovered, and he's a friendly giant. He's got a few extra inches or a few extra feet, but he's a friendly giant. No one should be afraid. He's not here to hurt us, and the giant begins to grunt or moan or whatever it is that they do, because whatever it is that they speak, because they're hidden away from humanity. So the giants are going to moan or grunt or grumble, whatever. If we see a 12-foot man, we should be scared of it, right? Wrong. Those who are led by the Spirit are not fearful of anything. Why? Perfect love casts out fear. Even if this thing is 20 feet tall, or 40 feet, or 100 feet, however much Satan wants to make himself, he'll never reach the throne of God. He'll never be at the top. He'll never be as powerful as God. So whatever it is that he throws or he brings under his time here on earth, it is still going to be crushed. Okay, here we go. One third of the angels has followed Satan and come to the earth. Two thirds have stayed with God. So for every demon that comes to attack us, there are two angels, two powerful God-sent angels that are fighting for us and taking out that demon. That's a small example. If a giant is 100 feet, God's big toe is like 500 feet. Do you see what I mean? The battle is fierce, but the battle is already won. God is the biggest thing, and that's what Father wants us to know, because he's been pressing on my heart like all of last night. Like, I've been up late studying, like trying to get some things in, but I think after the thing that I shared with you guys about what's his name, Henry, something like that, he witnessed the chaining of the angels. I don't know how I just stumbled on that. I loved it. How are they chained up? They're chained up to look up. Why? Because they have to look up. It's God that they have to glorify, each one of them. Whether they're as scary as they look, as big as they look, as dangerous as they look, whether they have the advantage in the physical sense, they got no advantage. Because we have the upper hand in the Spirit. Because God is ruling. He is reigning. God wants us to know, even though the reign of Satan will come, it will, but it's only because God is allowing him to. Satan cannot have any kind of time, no, not even a minute or a second or a millisecond, to reign above humanity. He cannot unless God permits him. And again, we'll see, how can God do this? How can he watch the innocent being slaughtered? What kind of evil is that? It's not evil. We can't see what he sees. on earth, an individual has 120 years, just like we read in Noah. In Noah, in Genesis 6. But with God, we have 1,000 and forever. Father knows that if we choose Him, we're going to have that 1,000 and forever. If we choose to go with Satan, not even 3.5 years, not even, we're going to be wiped out with the devil. It's going into hellfire. That's the end of him. That is his reign. He makes it sound so very good. Oh, I'm going to make it the best 3.5 years you ever had. And some people fall for it. Some people say, we have time, so let us eat and drink, for tomorrow we die. Or like the rich man who was foolish. He said, well, I accumulated all this wealth, but I'm just going to build another barn. And that's what he did. And God said, you fool, this night your soul will be required of you. You will give account for everything that you did. And there's a place prepared for the devil and his angels. Not for you, not for me, not for humanity. But if you want to go that way, then that place is for you as well. He said, you are of your father, the devil. I'm supposed to be finding all of these right now, but I'm going to do it later. Now. I'm going to do it now, Father. Now. I said I'm going to do it later, but I'm going to do it now. You fool, this night will be required of you. What did I say? So many things I said. You are of your father, the devil. Hell is prepared for the devil and his angels. The rise of the Nephilim. Enoch was a man, and he was not, for God took him. I don't know which one to take. The sleepiness or the mosquito. I think I'll take the mosquitoes. Okay. It's whose birthday? Okay, somebody just popped up and just kind of started me, but okay. So Enoch was a man who pleased God, and he was not, for God took him. Now, it is going to be an exciting time. I mean, dangerous, possibly scary, for those without the spirit, of course, but an exciting time. Imagine, the Bible says, your eyes have seen what the prophets long to see. Okay. Glory and praise. Okay, Matthew 13:17. I mean, the sight can't be reached. Of course, the sight can be reached. Matthew 13:17. Okay, here's what it says. Verse 16 onwards. But blessed are your eyes for the sea, and your ears for the why? I don't understand. Okay. They said it can't be found. Matthew 13:17. Which difference? Come on, open. Okay. Matthew 13:16 onwards. But blessed are your eyes, for they see, and your ears, for they hear. For surely I say to you that many prophets and righteous men desired to see what you see and did not see it, and to hear what you hear and did not hear it. Therefore hear the parable of the sower. All right. So, wow. So they preached about the thing, even about the crucifixion of Jesus, even about that. They were preaching about him coming and coming, and he didn't come. They died. They died, but they died in faith that he would eventually come, right? Just a second. Just like where they said it's still very bright outside and it's 6:30. Okay. So here's what he said. Right, they desired to see the Messiah come. And they didn't. Some didn't. But they still gave their life to preserve the word and all of that, right? Now, if they hadn't done that, we wouldn't have gotten the word, would we? All right. Just like when it says, as it was in the days of Noah, so shall be at the coming of the Son of Man. Do you think that Matthew or Mark or Luke or John desired to see how it was in the days of Noah, in the days of Jesus? Do you think that the Bible said sometime that the Bible said that they desired to see these things come to pass. Let's say that. Okay. The Bible says that they desired to see these things come to pass. They desired to see them or hear them, that they were even in those days, but they didn't. They died. With their faith, they died believing that it would happen. And of course, now the people who experienced the crucifixion of Jesus, I'm talking about people who were literally there, that generation, they bore witness of him. They bore witness that it happened. But now check this out. We get the lucky bones. When we snap the turkey bone, we got the big piece. We got the 2-in-1 special. We get to know Jesus as Savior and Creator. And we get to see just as how it was in the days of Noah. Noah might not have known that God was, just like remember when I say Abraham would not have known him as Jesus Christ, but he knew him as the Holy God. He knew him as the Savior. God our salvation. God is the Lord is our salvation. Or God our salvation. Check this out. No one knew that he was coming. No one knew that he would be there. That's why when Noah came out of the ark, he did the sacrifices. Remember when he did the sacrifices? Okay, let me just. Okay, Genesis 8:20 tells us that Noah built an ark to the Lord. The internet is messing up. Don't worry, I have the Bible. Verse 19, every animal and every creeping thing, every bird and whatever creeps on the earth, according to their families, went out of the ark. All right, so everything according to their species. It says families. Then Noah built an altar to the Lord and took every clean animal and every clean bird. And so he is keeping up. He's doing something that we're not even given yet. What is he doing? The Leviticus sacrificial laws, that's what he's doing, right? And it says, Noah built an altar to the Lord and took every clean animal and every clean bird and offered burnt offerings on the altar. And the Lord smelt a soothing aroma. And then the Lord said in his heart, I will never again curse the ground for man's sake. Although the imaginations of man's heart is evil from his youth, nor will I again destroy every living thing as I've done. And of course, God gave the beautiful rainbow that we saw this evening to remind us that he'll never destroy the earth by a flood. The Bible also says somewhere that God is not a man that he should lie. So he's not going to lie. He's not going to destroy the earth by a flood. But he is going to destroy the earth by what? He's going to purge it by fire. So it's not lying in an essence. Because he said by water. He promised. He won't do it by water. But he's God. He doesn't have to repent for what he does. So even if some people say, hey, he lied. He said he's not going to destroy the earth. But read the whole thing. By a flood. By water. All right. So Noah sacrificed unto the Lord. So the Leviticus laws that gave us the ordinances that God gave. Noah was already doing it. That was way before, way before. Noah was doing it. Because Noah was a righteous man. And he believed God. It was accounted to him righteousness by faith, like Abraham. So, what was leading Noah? The Spirit. The Spirit. So when Noah got instructions, okay, we're going to read some things here now. Pain, leave my arm right now. I slept with a kink and this morning I got up and I couldn't turn my neck. But, I went anyway. Went ahead. Now my arm hurts. Right here. Oh. I rebuke that pain. Pain, I curse you right now. In Jesus' name, you have no place in my body. Out. Right now. Out. Thank you, Father. Okay. Woo! Okay, that pain is gone. Yes. There we go. Okay. So Noah was doing what they would continue to do for generations until the coming of Jesus. Now, Abraham got to feel the pain that God, like a father losing his only son. Abraham got to feel that pain. So again, Abraham was doing according to the Spirit. He was not doing according to the flesh. So God audibly spoke to him. He did. Some of us, if we heard God speak audibly and gave us some kind of commands, we would run and hide. Knowing that we cannot hide from God, we would run and hide. Like Jonah. Okay? Okay, so Cain had a mark. Where are we? They're not finding my scriptures and they're trying to get me angry. So we were reading about our eyes seeing things that the prophets, they long to see and they long to hear. We got a 2-for-1 special. We have both. We know Jesus, so we have the Spirit of God dwelling in us, and we get to witness what Noah witnessed. So again, if a Bible could be written, guess what's going to be in that Bible? Our testimony. Now, the Nephilim is Satan's plan to overthrow humanity. He has an agenda, and that agenda is to cut down humanity to a controllable number. Satan might be a fallen angel, but he does not have power. He only has what God allows him to have. And therefore, he needs help. That's why he works in a coalition. The Bible says Satan divided against himself cannot stand, because he needs help. Like, God can be all things at once, needing nothing for sustenance or nothing at all. Satan needs help. That's why when we go to plunder the strong man's house, we bind up the strong man first. Okay, so Satan is that strong man, okay? That is, let me see if I can say this right. When we go to bring a soul to salvation or bring a soul to Jesus, we bind up the strong man. Now, Jesus said, "Will I find faith on the earth when I come?" Luke 18:8. You can find all sorts of things on the earth. Will you find faith? Is anybody going to believe the Bible? Is anybody going to be still holding on to the Word of God? Luke 18:8. Come on, give me 7 to 9. Will not God bring about justice for his elect who cry out to him day and night? Will he continue to defer their help, that is, ignore them? I tell you, he will promptly carry out justice on their behalf. Nevertheless, when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on the earth? He may find fear. He may find Oh, he's going to find evil. He's going to find all sorts. But will he find faith? Because people believe with seeing, not without seeing. To some who trusted in their own righteousness and viewed others with contempt, he also told this parable. Why does he add that in there? Because that's exactly what's going to happen. The kingdom of heaven is like a farmer. Okay, he says, to some who trusted in their own righteousness and viewed others with contempt. This one's more holy than this one, and this one more than this one, and self-righteousness. And the Bible says, all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Oh. Mm-hmm. When I say that, I hear him saying, Lord, forgive me, a sinner, tax collector. Okay, verse 9. To some who trusted in their own righteousness and viewed others with contempt. What does God say? I desire mercy, not sacrifice. He also told this parable. 2 men went up to the temple to pray. One was a Pharisee and the other a tax collector. The Pharisee stood by himself and prayed, God, I thank you that I'm not like the other men, swindlers, evildoers, adulterers, and even this tax collector. When all of a sudden it seems, and it says, so he's beating up his chest and he's like, oh, you know, I fast twice a week and pay tithes of all I receive. So he thinks that he is justified by the things that he does. He does not esteem Jesus then. Verse 13, but the tax collector stood at a distance, unwilling to lift up his head to heaven or his eyes to heaven. That's how we are. It's like in front of God, right? Instead, he beat his breast and said, God, have mercy on me, a sinner. I tell you, this man, rather than the Pharisee, went home justified. For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, but the one who humbles himself will be exalted. Now people were even bringing their babies to Jesus for him to place his hands on them. And when his disciples saw this, they rebuked them. But that's what he said, no one comes to him, but if they were a child only, okay? No one can enter into heaven. So in Matthew 13, we're looking at the prophets going to see what we see. What do we see? Is it by our physical eyes that we see these things? I mean, the things that are appearing on the earth, even as it was in days of Noah or times of old. Yeah, we see that. But most of the things that we see, we're seeing with a spiritual eye, right? That is the Holy Spirit showing us. That's a second. Okay, so I heard the rise of the Nephilim. So the rise of the Nephilim is the same thing that we're talking about, fallen angels with their own agenda. And their agenda is to enslave humanity and become gods and do all the crap that they could possibly do to get that accomplished. That is, kill some of humanity. Kill a large portion of humanity. Now, this is why Satan is on this earth, and he said, the Bible says, he's a father of lies. He is causing religion. He's the one causing doctrines, different doctrines. He's the one causing violence on the earth. He's the one who's reaping the havoc on the earth, that when he does that, the glory of God might be seen. He doesn't know that he's in the plan of God, but he should have taken his head out of the clouds. Matthew 25, verse 40 to 42. And the king will reply, truly I tell you, whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers of mine, you did for me. So remember, the Bible cautions us and tells us in those days men will be boasters and greedy and just lovers of self and evil and every possible thing you can possibly think of that is wrong, they will be. And it says, truly, I tell you, whatever you did for the one of the least of these brothers of mine, you did for me. And then he will say to those on his, left, depart from me, you who are cursed into eternal fire. Prepare for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me nothing to eat, and I was thirsty, and give me nothing to drink. So you're about your father's business, not God, but that is the worldly part of it. You want to accomplish worldliness. Now, Satan is the one who's quickening everything because he's hoping that so much violence erupt on the earth, like it was in the days of Noah, like it was in Sodom and Gomorrah, like so many instances, okay, where people were just doing their own thing, killing the innocent and the righteous wives, so that more souls could be lost. He doesn't care about the flesh in it. He cares about the souls. He doesn't want, his jealousy has blinded him. Remember the Bible says, where there is jealousy, there's every kind of evil. We're going to read John 8:44, but where there's every kind of evil, there's every kind of disorder, there's every kind of rebellion. James 3:16. James 3:16, reading from verse 15 to 17. Such wisdom does not come from above, but is earthly, unspiritual, demonic. Let's go a little bit further. So who's the one who's quickening? Remember last night when he showed us that we have a true vine and a false vine? There's a vine, the false vine. If Tarzan took hold of that vine to swing, he's going to come crashing down because that vine is not solid at all. James 3:15-16. If you harbor in your hearts bitter jealousy and selfish ambition, do not boast in it or deny the truth. Such wisdom does not come from above, but is earthly, unspiritual, and demonic. For where jealousy and selfish ambition exist, there will be every kind of evil practice. But all wisdom from above is first of all pure and peaceable, gentle, accommodating, full of mercy and good fruit, impartial and sincere. Okay, we're going into John 8. You are of your father, the devil. John 8:44-45. Remember, the seed of the woman is against the seed of the serpent, and vice versa, yeah? Reading from 43. Anybody think that these Nephilim or freak of nature or experiments of Satan is going to have good agendas if their father is a serpent? No. John 8:43-45. Why do ye not understand my speech? Even because you cannot hear my word. Why? Because they're spiritually deaf and spiritually blind, and they can't understand. That's bad. Ye are of your father, the devil. The lust of your father ye will do. He was a murderer from the beginning, and abide not in the truth, or abode. Abode means to abide, okay? Past tense. Because there is no truth in him. When he speaketh a lie, he speaketh of his own, for he's a liar and the father of it. And because I tell you the truth, you believe me not. Okay. So they believe the devil because they're from the devil. They know that their how to say it, their hearts, their minds, their actions, whatever they're doing it to his, they're not doing it to the glory of God. So they're not known by God. Remember when he said, depart from me, I do not know you, you evil who work of iniquity. Okay. Again, it's like the fool who's trusting in his gold. He says, I'll store up everything that I've gained and I'll relax for the rest of my life. And the Bible says in Luke 12:20. I'm getting kind of knocked out. Luke 12:19-21. Then I will say to myself, you have plenty of good things laid up for many years. Take it easy. Relax, man. Eat, drink, and be merry, just like it was in the days of Noah. But God said to him, you fool, this night your very life will be required of you. Then who will own what you have accumulated? This is how it will be for anyone who stores up treasure for himself and is not rich towards God. Okay, so God says always to keep our eyes above, on the things above, on the things that are eternal, not temporal, not perishing. Okay, the Bible says, though heaven and earth pass away, my word will forever remain. God is the living word. He wants that word inside of us at any cost. He wants to dwell in us at any cost. He wants us to die of self, die of flesh, die of everything that is not of him. Pride, die. Evil, die. Everything else, die. Everything that is not of God, die. And he wants his spirit to live in us, his spirit to quicken us. Because the place where we're going to is a spiritual place. It's not somewhere you can go and just indulge in unspiritual things, unholy things. No. There's no room for that. And if you're therefore in the flesh, then you'll not fit in there. It's going to be bad. So Father is quickening us. And he said, Satan wants the ruin of souls. That's what he's here to do. He's here to ruin souls. And he's bringing up his army, his experiments, his crazy experiments, that he may inflict fear into humanity, that they bow down and worship him. That is his end result. He wants to be God, but he cannot be God. He is a created being. Again, we looked at the Nephilim and them rising. Let me see if I lift out anything that he shared. We read that, right? We read Matthew 13:17 and Luke 10:24 is the same exact thing. So we are lucky. We are lucky to be seeing these days. We're lucky to be seeing these signs. The prophets, they just spoke. They thought the kingdom of heaven would appear imminently. They thought that things were going to happen, that they would see it in their lifetime, but they did not. But their faith did not waver. They carried on in the Lord. They endured till the end. And of course, their reward is set in eternity for them. Their reward, they shall be with the Lord. Ouch. They shall be with the Lord. They shall behold his majesty. They will be crowned with their many crowns. Their reward is set in heaven. It's in eternity. And of course, let me see Luke 10 if it tells anything different. Finally, it's dark. 6:48. Wow, that's late. Oh, it's still not dark. Still has some light outside. Luke 10, 23-25, and it says, "Then Jesus turned to the disciples and said privately, Blessed are the eyes that see what you see. For I tell you that many prophets and kings desired to see what you see, but did not see it, and hear what you hear, but did not hear it. One day, an expert in the law stood up to test him. Teacher, he said, what must I do to inherit eternal life? So the giants and whatever else that Satan has created, experimented and brought forth, he did not create anything. He experimented. He recreated. I don't know what to call that. He can't create anything. He experimented. Is going to try and force humanity to worship the beast. Now, okay, even now, I see the Vatican. Look what I'm doing. And I see that arc thing, that arc-shaped thing, that arch. I don't know, where's that? Okay. Anyway, I see the Vatican and those very tall doorways, and it's huge, isn't it? The Nephilim will be there. The giants will be there. Now, even as they were in times of old, huh, Father? The Nephilim will be there. They've already accommodated them. They already made accommodations for them when they should arrive, when they should come out of hiding. Now, it says, one day an expert in the law stood up to test him. Teacher, he said, what must I do to inherit eternal life? What is it written in the law? Jesus replied, and how do you read it? He answered, love the Lord your God with all your heart, your soul, your strength, and with all your mind, and love your neighbor as your So Father took, look what he did. He took the first five and he put it in a bracket. He put the second five in a bracket. And he categorized it under love. Love your God, do these. Love your neighbor, do these. You have answered correctly, Jesus said. Do this and you will live. Now, the man, he quoted the Ten Commandments right there, okay? And the first of the commandments is love your God alone, and don't make any graven images, no call his name in vain, and keep the Sabbath day holy, because it points you back to the Creator. They want to force humanity to worship Satan in whatever form he comes, as the Antichrist, as the beast, that is the kingdom of evil, the kingdom that exalts itself above God, which is he who is empowering the beast. He's giving the Antichrist power, he's giving the beast power, he's giving the prophet power, he's giving the false prophet power to deceive mankind. This is what he wants. He wants deception until it's too late, just like how it was too late when Eve bit into the fruit and she got kicked out of heaven. He wants that day of the Lord to come upon us, that we are not ready. But the Bible says, we are not children of the darkness, but children of the day. That this day should not overtake us as a thief in the night. First Thessalonians 5:5. Reading from verse 4. Verse 4 to 6. But you, brothers, are not in darkness, so that this day should overtake you as a thief. For you are all sons of the light and sons of the day. We do not belong to the night or to the darkness. So then, let us not sleep as the others do, but let us remain awake and sober. So many things are going to happen. It's going to seem like we lost. It's going to seem like Jesus is not coming back. It's going to seem like the Antichrist won. It's going to seem like just all the crazy things that you could think of. That, you know, people are going to give up in hopelessness. But that is crunch time. That is the time close to the midnight hour. Oh, I rebuke that, whatever it is, in the name of Jesus. Die by fire. Okay. What was I saying? Right. It's crunch time. It's the midnight. It's the hour, the minute approaching to midnight. It's crunch time. It's that time that you strain to keep your eyes open because the hour is late. And when the hour is late, you sleep normally. We are to be filled up and quickened by the Spirit of God. That is, you got to be taking care of yourself in a spiritual sense and a physical sense, okay? And just watching for that hour, watching for that day, desiring the Lord to come back, praying that He comes soon. Because could you imagine chaos rips on the planet, okay? Total chaos. And the fallen angels reveal themselves, and aliens are being received into humanity, and giants show up, and all these odd creatures. And it's like Narnia, the Chronicles of Narnia. It's like that in real. And total chaos. They want domination. They want to rule, and humanity's enslaved. And you're standing in the middle of everything chaotic, and you're saying, but the Lord is coming back, and He will come back very soon. You're one of the few standing in this chaos, saying the Lord Jesus is coming back. He's coming back very soon. And lo and behold, the day of the Lord comes. The sign of the Son of Man appears in the heavens. And He's coming on the clouds of great glory and splendor. And He's coming to exempt judgment. And the dead in Christ begin to arise because He shouts and the grave opens. Loose them! And the dead awaken. And then we who are alive are caught up in the air with Him. And then His fire begins to rain on the earth. Okay? Again, I'm going into the study tonight. I'm going to study the rise of the Nephilim, the rise of the giants on the earth. I'm going to be digging up every nook and cranny, seeking what I need. Because he's convicted me so strongly that this is not funny. And I'm just like, oh, expect dinosaurs to come back too. Expect them to show up. Come on, the fallen angels are here. I've seen that in vision already, a T-Rex. Because that's what they try to do. They try to scare humanity, and they want to bring the population down to a controllable number. So, expect it. This thing sounds like a Hollywood movie, I know. It does. In essence, it does. It really does, doesn't it? It sounds so far-fetched and so out of this world that it's almost unimaginable. But Satan has come down having great wrath against us. He's not here to do a party. He's not here to make humans feel comfortable and just, you know, he's a roar, the devil. No. He's here to bring souls down before they discover even the truth. And it's crunch time, it's go time. Time for the body to rise up and declare in whom we trust, which is Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. This thing was all over the place. I hope you got something to hide in your heart. Take something from it. The Bible says that to be awake and sober and alert, that the devil, he's come down having great wrath against the woman and her seed. That's the church and the Holy Spirit, the people being led by the Spirit. The ones that are shining the light in the darkness, the ones who are, they're lifting up the banner that God is sovereign. Even though you see all these nonsense happening, the giants, the dinosaurs, the mix-up of whatever experiment Satan has done, but God is still sovereign. He's still on the throne, and he's the one with the last say. All right, beloved, I'll leave you with these things in Jesus' name. Let's just pray. Father, we thank you, God, that you've just given a word through leading us to see that the Nephilim are on the earth, leading us to see that the giants are here and they will soon make an appearance, leading us to see that Satan is not here to play games, but he's here to destroy souls, to take the breath of life from us, that is, take us out of this life, because your word says that after death is judgment, and it is surely judgment, Father. So Satan is here to take down the population of humanity that is at a controllable number, just like he did in the days of Noah. Wickedness on the earth continually. We know, Father, that you said that you will not destroy the earth again with water, but you're going to destroy it by fire. You're going to refine it by fire. And Father, we just thank you that we're covered by your blood and we're filled with your Holy Spirit for that day of redemption. We thank you, Father, that whatever comes, however tall, however big, however scary looking, however much it exalts itself above you, whatever lie Satan comes with, Lord God, that your truth will be shining in the dark, Lord God, that your light will dispel darkness, that will stand on your word and will walk by faith and not sight, Father, knowing that these things are to come upon the earth and that we will see what the prophets long desired to see and even so are seeing in this day and age. We thank you that your name is a safe place and a high tower, that we run to it and are safe. We thank you, Abba Father, that your ways are higher, your thoughts are higher, that whatever you are allowing evil to do, that even so in this day and this hour, just like Joseph was thrown into the pit, you had a purpose for that. Just like the giants are coming on the earth, just like you allowed the daughters of men to bore giants, that your power might be seen, that they may know there is nothing that exalts itself above you. No experiment of Satan, no super creation, no superhuman, nothing that exalts itself above you shall prevail, Father. But you, Lord, of changing the battle into from physical to spiritual, that you are about to crush everything that Satan can bring. Because you're showing the reign of Satan and what happens, what happened if he would rule. You're proving why you're on the throne. You're proving why he was trodden underfoot and he was crushed. You're showing all things, and you're showing why you're the just and righteous God. And Father, we just glorify you, we bless you. And if you give another word, Lord God, we'll just come on and give it. as we examine what you give this morning, as we get into it, would you say, even so, Lord Jesus, come. Even so, Father, if we are counted worthy to escape that hour of testing that is coming upon the earth, even so, come. And if we're chosen to remain here and be a witness of you, let that come too. Because what an exciting time that's going to be. We're going to take down the fallen, not by might or by power, but by your spirit. Yes, Father. In your holy and most precious name, Jesus Christ. Amen and amen. I hope you hit something. I hope you could take something from this and hide it in your heart. The verses that I didn't find, just go dig it up, type it in, open a scripture page, type it in, and read the verse before and after. Maybe I can do this better another day or even later. I don't know. We'll see as the Lord leads. I just need to find out a lot about the fallen angels right now, about giants, because that thing is really pressing on my heart and my spirit. And as the earth begins to, well, it's crying out. These are the beginning of sorrows. Things are going to escalate and it's going to get very, very tough. That's why we ought to be walking in the spirit at all times, filling up in the word at all times. I'm going to come back tonight, and I think also I started it. I didn't know why I stopped. I read from chapter 1 to 18 one night, and I'm supposed to continually do that, but I think I've been pressing a lot to give sermons and give the word of God, that I didn't have time and not even the energy sometimes. But we'll do it all in Jesus' name, to the glory of God. Amen. God bless you, beloved. Bye for now. Bye. I need to eat something.